بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد رسول الله عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام. The topic today I'm going to talk about relapse and retention. The definition of the relapse, it is a return toward the pre-treatment condition. If I have a problem and I treat it orthodontically, there is a tendency for the case to return back to the pre-treatment condition. So relapse, it is the nature's objection of orthodontic treatment. Relapse should be regarded as undesired normal phenomenon rather than abnormal one. I do mean that the relapse is an undesired normal phenomenon. Forms of relapse. Relapsities may return to their former malocclusion partially or completely. That it can be returned either partially or completely, or establish a relationship that is entirely different from the original malocclusion. Here you can see there is a little bit relapse of the lower lateral incisor. And this is an extraction case. I did extraction of the four premolars. Here is the lower arch. You can see the contact between the lower left canine and there is a return back of the lower left second premolar. Here it is very obvious. How can you differentiate between failure and relapse? Relapse is a return in whole or part to the former state of malocclusion, while failure is due to incompetence or to unknown factors which interfere with the attainment of successful results. I failed to reach a final successful result. This is the failure. When orthodontic force is removed, the transitional bone is transformed into final character of compact alveolar bone. This takes from 6 months to a year or even longer. During this period of bone change following the cessation of the force, cessation means a stop of the force, relapse following orthodontic tooth movement or free movement of the teeth toward their original position can occur. This is very critical period. Once you finish the orthodontic treatment, you have to convince or attain the position of the teeth in their final position after treatment. So you have to convince the patient the importance of wearing the retainer, as we will see later. Apposition of bone caused by orthodontic force is in the form of temporary bundle bone, which later is relapsed by a more or less permanent lamellated bone. Here comes the importance or the more stable bone, permanent lamellated. Retention after orthodontic treatment must be continued until the substitution of the bundle bone by lamellar bone has occurred. Again, the lamellated bone is more stable than the bundle bone. The common relapse problems. Here you can see reappearance of crowding and rotation. You can see the area of the lower anterior incisors. And again here in the premolar area. Also here you can see the upper right central incisor and just after the treatment, when after 6 months there is a little bit relapse of the upper right central incisor. This patient didn't wear the retainer properly. This photo comes after 6 months after the final position attained. Number B, appearance or reappearance of species after full space closure, particularly in extraction sites. The extraction site is very, very important here. In a premolar extraction case, now there is a reappearance of the species that had been closed during orthodontic treatment. Again here, in a space closure for the median diastema, and you know, just after the treatment, you know, after the finishing of the treatment by a period of time. Number C, a tendency for the return of class 2 molar relationship with consequent overjet reappearance after reduction of the class 2 division 1 mag occlusion. All of you know that in class 2 division 1 there is an increase of the overjet. Causes of relapse could be improper diagnosis, poor treatment, or less than desired results. And for inherent growth, the active phase of treatment of many patients is completed while the facial growth is still in progress. You see the patient a little bit early, at the age of 10, 11, or 12, and you finish the treatment with 1 year or 2 years, and still there is growth. So you didn't measure what's going on after the finishing of the process of the growth. So thus some changes in the dentoskeletal relationship may occur. In class 3, after finishing the treatment, the mandible continues to grow, and here is the result as underestimation of the growth. Number 5 would be there is some bone changes. You can see here. Or there is a number 6, periodontal memory. All of you know that these are suspended in the bone through the periodontal ligament. In the cases of the rotation, apically there is circumferential periodontal fibers, less circular. Once you do the treatment, you corrected the tooth into the final correct position, and still the apical periodontal fibers not disoriented. So once you remove the retainer, there is a memory in the periodontal fibers to return back to the original position. Number 7, functional adaptation of occlusion. Number 8, persistence of undesirable oral habits. You receive the patient with bad oral habit, you didn't stop the bad, you didn't break the bad oral habit, you started the treatment, and again the patient returned back to the undesirable oral habit. This means that you didn't remove the cause. So before the start of any orthodontic treatment and there is an orthodontic problem due to oral habit, you have to stop the oral habit completely, and after that you start to correct the position of the teeth. In general, orthodontic treatment might not be started before the elimination of the habit, or treatment might be postponed until there is evidence that the habit will not persist. This is very, very important. Number 9, mishandling of the third molar. You finished the treatment and you didn't notice that the wisdoms are not in favorable position, so they can affect the final results of your orthodontic treatment. As you can see here, lower wisdoms, a little bit mesio oblique. So the problem comes from the anterior component of force due to this undesirable position of our unfavorable position of the lower third molars. Number 10, could be a gingival invagination after space closure. Yeah, you can see after the extraction of the first premolar. Yeah, the canine extraction of the 4, and this is the 5, this is the canine. Here, the invagination of the gingival tissue, so you should be removed before entering the retention phase. Well, this is a common problem during canine retraction and space closure. Treatment of rotation. Number 1, overcorrection. I talked a little bit before that there is memory of the periodontal fibers. So for the rotation, because I'm afraid from the circular fibers, the circular apical fibers, so should be over corrected, as when there is a tendency to return back to the original position, it will come to the normal position. So we do number 1, overcorrection. Number 2 is, I have a case with many orthodontic problems. You start firstly, or you start very early, with the correction of the rotated teeth. Number 3, excision of gingival fibers. Number 4, retention appliance. This is the treatment of rotation. First, we'll do overcorrection, early correction, excision of the gingival fibers, or retention should be retained correctly. Retention. This is the second part of my lecture to you, the retention. What do we mean by retention? Retention indicates biologic and mechanical preservation of post-treatment tooth position. How can you preserve the post-treatment tooth position? Thus, orthodontic treatment in reality consists of two phases: an active tooth moving phase, and the second phase is a retaining phase. Retention is maintaining newly moved teeth in position long enough to aid in stabilizing their correction. You have to take enough time for this stabilization. As we said before, that the tendency for the relapse comes at the first 6 months just after the orthodontic treatment. So retention is, you can consider it as a holding of teeth in ideal aesthetic and functional position. When I come to talk about the finishing and retention, so there is a treatment criteria. The following criteria are essential either prior or during the retentive period. Number 1, You have to establish good buccal intercuspid, good arch alignment and form, and three, good overbite and overjet accompanied by normal interincisal angle. This is the interincisal angle, is the angle formed between the long axis of the upper incisors and the lower incisors. A good proximal contact within the arches with no rotations. We have to eliminate the any rotations present. Good root parallelism or paralleling, especially at the extraction sites. We do extraction and I'm going to retract the canine to have a contact with the second premolars. You have to retract the canine in a bodily movement, and the longer axis of the canine should be parallel with the longer axis of the for otherwise if you did a tipping movement, it means that there will be no parallelism between the long axis of the canine and the fiber. Also, proper axial inclination with ascitic incisor position, as we said, flat occlusal plane, with establishment of proper muscle tone and muscular pressure, removal of the causative factor. Here you can see the intercuspation, interlocking, the long axis, there is a parallelism. So this case you can consider as being finished ideally. So the tendency for the relapse is minimal. You can see also the establishment of the midline, upper and lower, and the proper alignment and the ascitic positions. Now I'm going to talk about clinical applications. Number A, no retention is required. B, limited retention is required. Number C, permanent or semi-permanent retention is required. Number A, no retention is required. Corrected crossbites, as the interlocking will prevent the relapse. Suppose you have upper central incisor, upper central incisor in crossbite, and after the correction of the upper central incisor to the normal position, so the lower incisors will prevent the return back of the upper central incisor to its original position before the treatment. Corrections that have been achieved by retardation of maxillary growth, dental or skeletal. Suppose you are enhancing the growth of the maxilla, skeletal class 3 due to deficient maxilla, and you put the face mask and you started to protract the maxilla anteriorly. So you positioned the maxilla in a new corrected position. So there is a bone is formed or enhanced to form. After that, it will not return back to its original position. Dentitions that have been treated by serial extraction. All these three conditions, no retention is required. You can see here, as we said, there's a cross bite in the upper right lateral incisors, and here is the upper after correction, and the lower incisor and lower canine will prevent the return back of this lateral incisor to its original position. Here, the dentition in which the maxillary and mandibular teeth have been separated to allow for the eruption of the teeth previously blocked out. In this case, you know, there is a flap and did surgical exposure to the canine, and you started to move the canine to the correct position and through fixed orthodontic treatment, and this is the final position, so there will be no tendency to relapse as no retention is required. Number B, limited retention is required. Class 1 non-extraction cases characterized by protrusion and spacing of maxillary incisors, or class 1 or class 2 extraction cases, corrected deep overbites, retention here in the vertical plane. While the class 1 and class 2 extraction cases, the retention in anteroposterior plane. Cases involving ectopic eruption of teeth or the presence of supernumerary teeth, and early correction of rotated teeth to their normal position. And I talked before about the problem with the rotation. Permanent or semi-permanent retention, cases in which expansion has been the choice of treatment. I have a collapsed arch and I started to expand the collapsed arch, particularly in the mandibular arch. Why we say particularly the mandibular arch, as the mandibular arch is contained within the maxillary arch, and the effect of, especially for the expected effect of the buccinator muscle, is very important, buccinator and the masseter. cases of the considerable or generalized spacing is very important. If you started personal treatment with the case of the generalized spacing, then this means that the tooth-arch relationship, there is disproportioning. So here we have to put permanent retention in the cases of generalized spacing. Cases of severe rotations, particularly in adults or severe labiolingual malposition. Spacing between the maxillary incisors, the median diastema. The duration of the retention. The period varies greatly in different cases, varying from few weeks to a year or longer. All major corrections should be retained at least 12 months on 24 hours wearing of the retainer, followed by 6 months night wear only, followed by wearing 3 nights a week and day after day, 3 nights a week, with gradual tailing off if the case appears stable. This sequence is very important. When we feel that the recently moved teeth or modified arches have been harmonized in function with all the forces to which they are subjected. The appliance may be removed and the case should be kept under close observation. Don't terminate the relationship between you and your patients once you remove the retainer, but you have to make a follow-up after that. It is much better to tell both parents and the patients told to of this sequence at the beginning of the active treatment. They should understand this point very clearly. Now I'm going to talk about the types of the retainers. The type of the retainer given depends on the patient's initial malocclusion, the patient's growth stage, the patient's current occlusion, and the patient's preference. Fee removable, we have removable retainers with the only of the only questionable aspect is the if is their dependence upon the cooperation of the patient. This is the problem with the removable approach. If you don't trust your patient, don't make the removable retainers, do the fixed one. So the only questionable aspect is their dependence upon the cooperation of the patients. Here is standard Hawley retainer, base plate, short labial arch with two Adams clasps. We have two types. This is a passive retainer, does not induce any force, and the festooning of the acrylic plate comes in contact with the parietal aspect of surfaces of the incisors, and the heavy round wire comes in contact labially, so it will not allow the teeth to move. But if there is a tendency for the relapse, or you notice that there is little bit relapse, you can do this active retainer, do palatal spring, and you can do activation in this part, the spring, to align the teeth back instead of going or going through on complicated fixed osmotic procedures. Also, we have rubber finishing appliances. With this appliance is bridging the span between the multi-band appliance, or fixed one, and the conventional retainers. These appliances have been available in either rubber or plastic. With this appliance, looks similar to an acrylic mouse guard. Or this one. lower retention appliances. As in the case of upper, this consists of a plastic base with molar grips, clasps, I do mean, and a short labial bow. Such a retainer can hold the teeth in the lower arch, prevent the lingual movement of the lower incisors, or migration of the lower molars. Invisible retainers. This is acetic type of retainers. This is acetic types of retainers. The acetic acceptability to the patient is very, very high, and it may experience with today patients, if an appliance is not aesthetically acceptable, it is doomed to failure. Here, this one is the aesthetic type. It's very transparent. Here, the final alignment, the final appearance of the case after orthodontic treatment, and this is the invisible retainer, which has a high aesthetic advantage. It is clear in here with the wearing the invisible retainer. This very clear one. And you have to ask the patient don't to drink hot drinks or colored drinks, like the Pepsi and like that, that it will change the transparency of these appliances. Now we come to the another type which is the fixed retainers. Before I talked about the removal retainers here, they buy fixed appliances. You can see after the finishing of the case, here you can see a palatal fixed retainers through special wire has been prepared for that. Not similar to the wire used in the alignment of the teeth, and through a composite it is directly bonded to the palatal expert. It is in aesthetically is good, much better with a stubborn patient or the patient that you don't trust that they are going to wear the removable appliances. So short bonded labial retainers in two patients with palatally impacted canines, number A before the treatment, and this is after the treatment. This case, and this is another case. Another type is 5-to-5 retainer. This is an old one using orthodontic band. And after finishing the phase of the retention, you can remove this one. The importance of maintaining the good or the health of the periodontal conditions during the fixed retainer is to do flossing in such way below the wire. In this we use the dental floss. This another type, this is, we name it wave retainer. It's like this, that will help the clearance of the interdental spaces by the dental floss. Here you can do segment retention using a piece of wire, twisted flex wire, and bonded from the in an extraction case. This is the canine and this is the four. As we said before, we are afraid from the relapse at the area of the extraction phase at it may reopen. And also in a here upper, in a lower. And this adult class two scissor bite extraction. Scissor bite patient with both short and long labial retainers before the treatment, and the retainers are after the treatment involving extraction of maxillary first and mandibular second premolars, and you can see here. This is before and this is after. Usually in class two, we remove upper four and lower five. And the way of the performing this very simple retainer, just piece of wire and the composite, as you see here, after doing etching. This is fixed bonded retainer. Piece of acrylic and the labial and twisted flex wire or braided wire and fear retention by muscle exercise. Once the occlusal mad relationship has been occurred, it is possible to institute muscle exercise by exerting correct forces upon the dental arches. Exercises aid the maintenance of normal occlusion by training the muscles to normal behavior to establish a normal balance of muscular forces. Thank you.